Blackstone presents The Spectacular Miss by Sonia Bahl. This book is read by Soneela Nankani. Mama and Dad. For a childhood even the smartest kid couldn't have imagined. 1. It's a boy. At 8, I had just one overpowering, all-consuming, won't-back-down wish. To pee standing up, like a boy. To be allowed the liberation of spraying in any direction I pleased, make pee rings if I chose to, or aim straight for the pot, toilet seat up. You know, like good boys do. That's what kept me up in the nights. But it didn't happen. For a good reason. I was born with a vagina, not a penis. Biology can be a bummer, but not if you studiously ignore it. I had chosen to turn a deaf ear, a blind eye, and sometimes even a foul mouth to its unreasonable boundaries right from the time I learned to dress myself. Until age 5, I suffered all my mother's sartorial confections, lacy apparitions, stiff skirts that housed even stiffer, starchy, scratchy can-cans underneath. Frills, ruffles, layers, lace, pink. Death. Age 6 was a time of liberation. Hold on. Before I go any further, it's imperative you channel your inner iPod and hear the first haunting strains of the iconic The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly background score. Enter skinny kid, oversized collared shirt tucked into clingy nylon short shorts. Today they're made with almost as much science that goes into launching a rocket and have some fancy schmancy name like Spanx and are worn mostly under skirts during sports. I ask, what's the point? Nobody would dream of wearing them as a standalone option unless they're looking for a verbal beheading by the fashion police. In their prehistoric, elasticity-challenged avatar, when mere bending could slit them in half, they were my favored choice of garment. Turn on that fashion photographer's camera and allow it to pan down so you can see the skeletal, slightly knock-kneed legs ending in white canvas shoes, the ubiquitous PT shoes of the era, and black socks. Not exactly sure why black. A subliminal nod to macho, if I have to hazard a guess. Let's not get distracted. Important detail coming up. Hair. The mother-braided, neat, girly locks had been replaced by an Elvis meets urchin do. The result of scissors in the hands of a 6-year-old girl desperate for sideburns. The rest was achieved after a visit to her dad's barbershop. Best day yet. So I'm ready. Boy meets world, arguably minus one essential component. Did that stop me from becoming the ringleader of the neighborhood boys aged 6 to 10? No. Did it stop me from believing I could outplay, outshout, outcurse any boy worth his slingshot? Fuck no. Did I become the kind of sister and older brother, let's call him Nikhil, Nick, thinks he can wish away by blatantly ignoring in public? Resounding yes, except I was as easy to ignore as the flaming orange-red mercurochrome on my perpetually scraped and cut knees. Here's the irony for Nick. Being just 3 years younger than him, I was snapping much too close to his Bata naughty boy shoes for him to delve into his preteen heart for any scraps of generosity or affection. Ignoring me, while I was passing off as a cross-dressing miniature mafiosi, was his tortured and wary coping mechanism, which is why he found it completely horrifying that our brother Rahil, Ra, 10 years older than me, found my odd behavior endearing, even brag-worthy. It was on one such evening when I was making an idiot of myself in public, something I did with reliable frequency, that Ra brought home a friend.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.